We're just about to start. I'm going to start. Everybody will bring your attention up here to the front. And I would like to welcome you here to the Lubbock Liberty Mayoral and City Council Candidate Forum. It is an honor to have the opportunity to be able to present this to you. I'm Amanda Smith, co-founder and organizer for Lubbock Liberty. Lubbock Liberty has hosted many educational workshops and candidate forums since about 2013. So I invite you to go and look at the previous events. You can view those at lubbockliberty.com. I encourage you to check those out. Please feel free to access the restrooms at any point right behind these walls back here on the other side. I ask that everybody maintain a peaceful and respectful atmosphere by turning off your ringtones and saving all questions and comments for the end. We did have public input originally, and so we would like y'all to kind of keep those comments to yourself for now. That way we have enough time to get through, because we don't have a lot of time. We're always under time constraints, as with everything in life. So each candidate is going to have their own segment of time to answer the questions that we formulated to address issues affecting individual liberty in our community, and to highlight what's most important to each candidate. Candidates are limited to 2.5 minutes in order to cover at least 4 questions. If they're able to get through the first 4 questions quicker, then we will actually add some more questions in for some other topics that we'd like to get to. We do have a timekeeper right back at the back, Erin Saproni, if you'll wave your hand. She will be putting up a 10-second mark when it gets towards the end of your 2.5 minutes for those 4 questions. So, running for District 2, lifelong resident of District 2 and longtime dedicated youth advocate, Sheila Patterson Harris. If you'd like to come up here, begin, and I will start asking the questions.
You can clap if you'd like.
Good morning, Sheila. And your first question is, I'd like you to take a few minutes to tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for District 2.
All right. Good morning. I am Sheila Patterson Harris. And as Amanda stated, I'm a longtime resident of Lubbock. You can probably tell by the color of my hair. But I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for having me here, and thank you guys for coming. This whole process, which is totally new to me, whether you believe it or not, has really been humbling for me, and also has been a huge challenge for me as well, for no other reason other than having me start developing a shorter way of communicating to folks. So, but I count that a plus as well. But what I want to talk about with regards to why I'm running and why I should be the candidate, I have to say that I have had the experience of actually watching and noting the time consideration, the time commitment, the sacrifices that it takes to serve in such a capacity. So having watched my dad serve for so many years, there were a lot of things that had to be done, a lot of time that had to be taken away. So what I've done is I've strategically planned things in my life so that I can be available to do that. Number one, I've reared my children. They're grown and gone. And I have also retired from the Juvenile Justice Center after over 20 years of service there, working with so many families and young people, and enjoyed every minute of it. I do know that District 2 needs representation. And they need representation by someone who's not afraid to do the right thing, to make the right decision, to make difficult decisions, to make hard choices, and even represent folks even when you don't agree with what they're saying. So that is huge, and that's very important for a council person. I believe that I can get the job done. I'm not gonna compare myself to any of the other candidates, because I have to just talk about what Sheila can do and allow you to make your decision based on that. As I stated, I did things strategically so that I have retired, have my children gone, and all of that, and be ready to take on the task of the concerns of City Hall. I've had the opportunity of being in so many homes through every corner of the city of Lubbock, so I've been able to see the things that actually affect citizens, and it affects the choices that they've been able to make or not make as a part of their lives. District 2 is pretty diverse, so it's going to cause for some diverse things to take place in order to be cared for.
Great, Sheila. And if elected, what steps do you think that we can take as a community to reduce the debt our city has accumulated?
Actually, that's not a brain surgeon question, I believe. I believe in living within our means. I believe we take the funds that we have, the funds that we collect by ad valorem tax, by sales tax, the transfers and things like that, and we use them to make sure that we do, that the council does what it was set up to do. And that is to take care of the needs of the citizens. That's what it was set up to do. And I think that we do that by staying within our means, that we have the proper checks and balances to do so. The good thing about it is that this, a lot of the debt that we do have, and debt in itself is a necessary part of running a city because of we wanted to have the growth, we wanted to do things well. The good thing about it is that we're looking to pay off so much of the debt that has been a part of our budget by because of the water systems and things like that we were taking care of and some of the other capital projects. So as we begin to take care of those things over the next few years, that we've not replaced that debt with huge additional amounts of debt. It's kind of strange when I opened up the paper this morning, bam, there it was, that the council has acquired the certificates of the bonds for the project for the Omni building, so to be Citizens Tower and other issues. Not quite pleased with some of the things that they're having under that and having those bonds to be used for. But I think the best way to handle that is take a look at what we have. Find the things that are necessary to take care of the citizens. Make sure and ensure that we do those things, that we develop maintenance programs to make sure that we take care of the things that we have. Not sure we've done that to the best of our ability. I'm trying to watch for that sign because it came up on me a few minutes ago. So that would be my first step, is actually take a look and get inside, take a look to see exactly where we are with the additional information that's not always privy to the citizens that should be privy to the council person.
Excellent, Sheila. And what is one of the most important issues facing your city or your district? And if elected, how would you address it?
Well, I've had the opportunity to kind of meet with a lot of citizens in District 2. Not all, because District 2 is a huge area. I tell you what, it goes from here to there, especially geographically. There are folks all the way in Yellow House Canyon. There are folks in Chapel Hill, outside the loop, and all of that. So there's so many citizens. But we counted a pleasure to represent them. And so with that, my concern should be their concern. And what I found that they have several concerns in groups, I'll say, and they differ a little bit. Those areas are safety, and of course, throughout the city, it's going to be the safety in regards to crime. But there are also concerns with regards to air quality. There are concerns for some of the citizens with regard to noise. There's concern for many citizens being able to receive immediate care or emergency services. There's been instances that citizens have advised me that the police or the EMTs couldn't find their location. So there are also concerns of being able to commute safely between communities by having safe walkways and things to maneuver themselves. There are also the concerns of deteriorating, declining property value, caring for property, and things of that nature. And in addition to there being a concern of lack of communication and relationships between the citizens and the city of Lubbock. One way, and I'll start from the bottom and try to back my way out of this thing, with regard to developing the relationships, we have to begin to meet citizens where they are. We have to make sure that we make ourselves accessible. As your council person, I will make sure that I'm accessible. I've done so by taking on some things that I have not done before. I'm a Facebooker now. And I think I'm doing quite well at it. I'm going door to door. I'm having to speak out. So some of the things that we've done as a part of the campaign process are some things that we're going to carry as we move into City Hall. With regard to deteriorating and declining property, in specific areas, I believe that there are things that we can do to promote and prepare for development. And as we do that, we begin to do some rehabilitative work. We begin to take care of call for folks to be accountable and take care of the properties that they have, be it homeowners or those who are renting property to many of our citizens and allowing them to move in places that they should not be allowed to move in the first place. with regards to safety in the other areas. I'll speak specifically to the...
Alrighty. We're actually going to have to move on. You do have, actually, if you could continue for just a few more minutes, or you could go on to the next question. Which would you like to do?
Can I just bear this thing in mind? And I speak to this because many citizens, primarily in the Chapman Hill area, have a concern of air quality. They have been plagued with pollutants in the air that have gone scaled back by an entity there. They have been good neighbors, that entity has been good neighbors for the most part. However, there's still been concerns affecting the health of so many of the citizens who live in that area. But good news is for those citizens, we formed a relationship with PICO over there, and they have a $40 million project that's coming down the pike that they have actually started doing some things with that will begin to affect that. So developing relationships with individuals, making the citizens' concerns known, and working with things so that we can make the right decisions and make a change.
Excellent. Very good job.
Can I ask one more question? Could you raise that these are trifocals, and if you don't get it at the right angle, I'll miss it.
Thank you so much. And we've got one more minute for you, and I just wanted to ask you, this may be a loaded question, so it's not. Annexation of property outside the city limits has become a significant subject for our community. If elected, how would you protect property rights while still encouraging development of our city?
Glad you asked. I've said often, I'm not opposed to annexation. I'm not. I believe that the city should continue to grow and be a great place to live and cause for individuals to live in. However, I believe that there are areas within the city currently that can be developed, that things can be done to make things more inviting and take care of the citizens who might be moving into the area or be encouraged to move into the area. I get concerned when we make decisions that become intrusive on other citizens. I believe that those citizens who moved outside of the city have done so for many reasons. And I believe that we have to respect that idea that was their decision and not be intrusive upon them. However, if we're in a situation where they're in agreement or something along those lines, I see no reason not to develop a relationship and try to see what we can make happen. But it kind of goes back to the budgeting things that we begin to use and take care of the things that we have. And I understand the process of thinking with those folks doing that, saying that the increased property would bring more taxation into it. However, if we begin to take care of the things that we have, we promote development and growth, if you will, within areas that are not in the same stand, I believe that we're able to do and encourage and take in some of the same taxation or increase some of the same taxation that we are actually looking to provide through annexation.
Very great.
Okay.
All right, and we appreciate you coming today, and I know that she's got some other events that she's got to get to. I encourage everybody to go and check her out. And you have a website?
I do not have a website. I'm not that tech savvy.
But you're on Facebook.
I'm on Facebook at Sheila Patterson Harris. Yes. For District 2. I thank you for your time.
Thank you so
much.
And
I'll do something before I take my seat and have to bow out. You don't ask for nothing, you don't get nothing, is what I'm told. So I'll ask for your vote, those of you who are members of District 2.
Thank you. Our next candidate is running for mayor. He is a local business owner and Lubbock Independent School District Board of Trustees President, Dan Polk. And I will ask you that same first question. Take a few minutes to tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for mayor.
Great. Thanks, thanks, Amanda. It's great to be here this morning. My name is Dan Pope. I'm an eighth-generation Texan. I think it might be of some interest to you since we celebrated San Jacinto Week Day this week that my forefather, who came with Stephen F. Austin and Jesse Burnham, when they voted in 1845, if I've got it right, whether or not to join the Union or not, was one of the ones that voted not to join the Union. My father reminded me of that this week when we were talking. I thought the constitutionalist group might find that of some interest. It's just a bit of trivia. My wife and I'm a Texas Tech grad. I left Lubbock in 1985 and to work for a major corporation. Came back here in 1994 and started a business. We operated that business for 20 years. Grew it from from zero jobs to 70, more than 70 jobs, and had a chance to sell our business a few years ago. We've raised two children here. They're both college age, both out of Lubbock, going to college. We've got plenty of time to do this job. I've also had a lot of opportunities outside the private sector. I've served the last 9 years on the Lubbock School Board. I chaired the United Way campaign in 2005. I've been very active at our church at First Methodist. I believe the things that differentiate me when it comes to running for mayor is my ability to get people moving together in the same direction. I've worked in large organizations, and I believe that I have those skills. I have the common sense that we need at City Hall. I can say no. I can live within a budget. I can plan for the future. I can bring some civility and some accountability to City Hall. I understand that the role of government is very limited, that it's really about the private sector. It's not about what we do at City Hall. We need to serve the citizens. We need to provide water and electricity and make sure that we take the trash and that we get water off the roads. We need to protect our neighborhoods and businesses and homes with fire and police. We need to make sure we have good streets to travel on. We need to take care of what we already have, but we really don't need to get into a lot of things that somehow or another our city seems to find themselves in the middle of. So I'll stop there.
Very good. No problem. We'll go on to the next question. If elected, what steps do you think that we could take to reduce the debt our city has accumulated?
First of all, we need to quit adding to the debt. You know, that's the easy part of this. That's the part of saying no. I mean, we've councils for many years, including the current council, have financed street maintenance, as an example. I mean, we pay for some street maintenance out of the budget, we finance some. We issue 10-year bonds for street maintenance that very rarely last 10 years. In fact, 5 and 6 and 7 years, most more often. We finance vehicles. The city has more than 1,900 vehicles. We have our own fleet department. We've got our own shop. We keep vehicles for a long period of time. There's no reason to incur debt for vehicles. If we can't afford to pay cash for vehicles, then we need to wait and do it next year, much like we would do in our own home. So you start with that. You also start with live within the budget. And when we start to roll a bunch of debt off, which we will, we've got more than $400 million of our debt is related to water. The first part of that debt, if I got my numbers right, I believe starts to come off the books in 2020. We'll have paid for it in 2020. What we've got to do is make sure that as it goes off, we're not replacing it with more debt. It's really not a complex issue. It's the ability to say no. It's to get involved in the budgeting process and to take a little bit of ownership of it.
Thank you very much. And what is one of the most important issues facing your city that you believe? And if elected, how would you address it?
City Hall needs to be more responsive and more accountable. City Hall needs to be more open. We need to communicate better. Just a couple, three things. The city is abysmal when it comes to communicating. The website's very much behind times. Go to the website and try to find a phone number. Just go do a search and try to find a phone number of a city employee. It's very difficult to do. Try to find an org chart. Very difficult to do. They're there, but you've got to be a bit of a Sherlock Holmes to find it. You know, we went 36 hours during the snowstorm in late December where the city went dark. Absolutely dark. The only place you could find out what was going on was on the mayor's Facebook page. I mean, come on, we're better than that. We're nearly 250,000 people. We've got to communicate better. Also, we need to serve citizens. The planning department and all things related to construction, whether you're a homeowner trying to do something where you need a variance, or whether you're a developer or somewhere in between, We're not responsive. Plan reviews taking between 45 and 60 days. We sort of lost our way down there. That's not the way this city's always been. I think part of the reason why is that we don't have the leadership we need at City Hall. And I'm not talking about the elected leadership. I'm talking about the employee leadership. We need a strong city manager. We need the right type of assistant city managers. We need to set levels of expectation. If you're a citizen that's coming down there to ask to go through the process to get a zoning variance, for example, you should know how long that's going to take. It shouldn't be file it and wait. And that's a bit of what we have right now. We can be a lot better.
Very good. And annexation of property outside the city limits is definitely a significant issue. Just like we had Sheila answer, I'd like you to give your perspective. If elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Sure. So a couple things on that. One, I do believe we need to grow. But I think we need to grow while we're taking care of what we have. We need to adopt an annexation plan. We had a group that the council appointed that was citizen-led with Councilwoman Joy was the council person that sat on that group. It's also had a bunch of staff that did, I thought, very, very good work. You can find their work on the webpage, the city webpage, I believe. If you can look and find it, it's actually a good read. I'm not sure we need to adopt that plan exactly, but we need to adopt a plan. We owe it to people that live outside the city, okay? Because we are going to grow, and just because you relocated 5 miles or 6 miles or 7 miles south of whatever at some time, that doesn't mean that the city's not going to eventually get to your home. You may have to move again. That's sort of been the American part of my family, that the ones that were trying to stay away from civilization and the law moved for many years as they moved from the Shenandoah Valley across the country. That sort of goes along with our heritage. But we need a plan. I talked to a business owner the other night. She's on 114th Street and Tokahawa. She has a use, her business has a use that would be incompatible with being part of the city. All she wants to know is what our plan is. I think we owe that to people. Final thing, state law drives in. The state law is for annexation, the rules about annexation are. We follow the state law when it comes to that. The council's done, I think, a nice job of that. I frankly do not support the policy that the council has just approved or is in the process of approving, where we're carving out a piece of what we could end up with a city, but an unincorporated area surrounded by the city itself. I think that's the wrong message to send. I think it's sort of politics at its best.
Very good. And just, you got one more minute, and I just wanted to add one last part of that. Do you think that we should move to a supermajority vote of affirmation for the affected landowners that are being annexed? It's a yes or no.
I mean, I think the charter we have today is sufficient. It's a supermajority. We have to have nearly 60% today, 4 out of 7 to do anything. So, I mean, I don't see. I think there's many more important things than opening up the charter right now. We need to take care of the A's and B's. The charter's a C or a D, in my opinion. Let's take care of the most important things first. It's a classic example of the way that the city has been run, is that we're down some rabbit trail. I don't think our citizens want that. I think it wants to do the few things the city is supposed to do very well.
Very good. And then maybe a half a minute left here. So what level of involvement do you feel that the federal government should have on our city government?
As very little as possible.
All right, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very much. We got block walking going on. I'm going to wait and hear these guys, my opponents, and then I'm going to come in. But thank you
so much
for watching. DanPopeForMayor.com, DanPopeForMayor on Facebook.
All right. I would like to also introduce to you running for mayor, attorney at law, and long-term city councilman, Victor Hernandez.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and why you think you're the best candidate for mayor.
Well, I'm 54 years old. I've been living in Lubbock about 33 years. Between my wife and myself, we're both attorneys, but we have 5 college degrees, and about 37 years of public service. I've served on the council 16 years, previously served as mayor pro tem. One of my strengths, I believe, is speaking out. There's too many folks down at City Hall who want to go along to get along. And they want to go along to get along for personal interests or for their buddies' interests. And that's not the sort of leadership we need down at City Hall. I opposed LPNL giving $3.5 million to Texas Tech for a skybox. And in my opinion, that was the trade-off there was for Whitney City to get a seat on the Texas Tech Board of Regents. My opponent is part of an investment group here in town, and he says he'll recuse if he is elected mayor. Should they come back and ask for the $1 million, which they already asked this current council for, of taxpayer dollars for their development downtown, he'll recuse in the future. So he's going to say no to his business partners, his former business partners in the future. Too much of that is going on and has gone up. The trick is, I've been around 16 years. I know the games that are played down there. And I've been the only one who stands toe-to-toe with these folks and says, no, it ain't going to happen. Not under my watch. So that's, you know, people say I'm too aggressive. I like to say I'm passionate. People don't need folks down there who don't say anything. People don't need folks down there who just go along. I am an attorney. I'm an advocate. I've been an advocate for citizens in this city for over 25 years, both on a professional level and as a public servant.
All right, we'll move on to the next question. If elected, what steps do you think we should take to reduce our debt?
That's one of the things that's broken down at City Hall. And I will encourage you to read my response in the AJ tomorrow. The original city charter had four positions appointed by council. One was a city treasurer, and that was gotten rid of. Right now, we don't even have a chief financial officer. For a $730 million budget, what's happened over the years is the city manager is not only in charge of the management, he's in charge of the finances. So what ends up happening, and this is a good example, this group came to the council and said, we need $1 million. The majority of the council, there was no vote, but it's my understanding, the majority of the council said, well, that's a good idea. So I visited with the city manager. Where are you going to come up with this $1 million? Well, you know as well as I do, we're going to have to cut in the budget and other programming in other departments to come up money for them. There's a conflict of interest between the city manager handling the management and the finances. You got to separate those two. So I'm proposing we get the city treasurer position filled and all of our financial departments under that person, which then becomes a direct report, just like the city manager, to the council. There's independence, there's accountability. Then we can start tackling the city's finances.
Very good. And what is one of the most important issues facing your city that you believe, and if elected, how would you address it?
It's rampant right now. The amount of conflicts of interest going on at City Hall. We've got a master developer cutting deals with these groups. We've got members of our LEDA board who are part of an investment group. Members of our downtown TIF board who are part of this investment group. If you read tomorrow's AJ, one of the top three things is the creation of an ethics review commission, where people can file sworn complaints and an ethics review commission will take a look at these things and say no. You can't do that. You need to put a stop to that. Next question.
Yes, and if you elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging development of our city? And this is to do with the annexation of property outside the city.
We don't want to become another Chicago. But by the same token, we need to understand that additional annexation of land, wherever, costs this city, the current citizens of this city, money. By the, what I mean is, we don't want another Chicago. Chicago has an inner city that's highly depressed as a result of the flight outside of the city limits. There's no tax base to support the inner city. We don't want that here. But by the same token, people have to understand these additional annexations cost the current citizens money, because by law we're required to put in certain infrastructure. Developers will tell you, oh, it's a pay-as-you-go. They will tell you, and they've told the council on camera, 10 to 15 years to recover that expense. So who's footing the bill now? You are, the current citizens of Lubbock. There has to be a balance. It has to be managed growth.
All right, and for the other question is, what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
I know this group, so I can answer what my opponent answered. Oh, very little. Come on, man.
I think it's as little as possible.
Thank you. As little as possible. Come on, man. It's a partnership, folks. When I raise my hand as a council member, when I raise my hand as a captain of the United States Army, I took an oath to protect the laws of this state and of the United States. Whether you folks like it or not, we are part of the United States. We are part of the state of Texas. We are in a partnership. And if you don't like it, then talk to your friends down in Austin. But I'll defend it. I went overseas. I fought in Operation Desert Storm. I will defend it. I have defended it.
Very good answer. And for water usage during times of drought, it's always a major issue for every community. So which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
Yeah, it's a balancing act there too. I mean, all of these questions, there's no simple answer, folks. We want to conserve water, especially in this part of the region, and we want to set up a water rate structure to where people who use less water pay less. I understand that. But we've got infrastructure to pay for. So if you really, since the city, if you really push water conservation, your water rates are going to go up. It's that simple, because the bill has to be paid. But as to which type, reclamation. That's the key. I was born and raised in El Paso. They've been reclaiming water for decades. As most people say, what's the biggest problem with reused water? It's getting the thought out. That's it.
And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services, specifically related to weather disasters?
Well, and again, you need to read my response in the AJ, but basically we need to be more proactive and prepare better. We dropped the ball during July, no doubt. We didn't drop it completely, but we dropped the ball. And I think citizens expected more. I know I did. So what you do is you regroup, reevaluate, you plan better, and move forward.
Very good. You have about one more minute. Would you like to add anything?
I will tell you, I'm a hard pill to swallow. People either like me or they dislike me. There's no in between with me. I'm okay with that. I did not assume this position of responsibility to be liked. I assumed this position of responsibility in order to do what's right. And we've lost that. People do, and I like Dan, but you know, my question is motives. I mean, he knows that, it's no surprise. But as a man, as a person, he came up to me and invited me to breakfast 3 months ago. And I told him, if I run for mayor, and if I'm negative, it's got to come out of this mouth, not somebody else's. He He said he was going to be nice. I said, you're no fun. That's me. I appreciate your vote. What you see is what you get. It's not sugar-coated, but it's honest and it's straightforward. Thank you.
Good. Thank you so much. And also running for mayor, I'd like to introduce former city councilman and longtime community advocate, Todd Klein.
Thank you, everyone. I'll try to be as brief as possible. We'll see how many questions Amanda has.
First, I'd like to take let you take a few minutes to tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for mayor.
Okay. The reason I'm running, because you asked a great question. I sometimes always reframe that. I'm not running against anybody. I don't have opponents. I have people that are seeking the same position. I don't need any job in life so bad that I have to lie to you, make up gimmicks, or attack somebody. If I have to tear somebody down to build myself up to be your mayor, don't vote for me because I'm not worried to be your mayor. I'm running because I care about you as people. I spent 2 terms in the council. Some of the things that I worked on as a Liberty candidate was getting rid of the red light cameras. They were placed in minority areas. Why? Because minority areas were close to the interstate. It was a revenue scheme that preyed upon the least among us at the expense of public safety. In fact, red light cameras, if you do your homework, and that's the hallmark, people may say they don't always agree with me. One of the highest praises I get when I run for, or when I'm out in public is, you know, sometimes I don't agree with you. But what I love about you is that you explain yourself. The other thing that I take pride in is that I don't think anybody will ever say Todd Klein doesn't do his homework, or that, you know, of all the council members, Klein's not the most studied on this issue. I take the job seriously. If I'm elected to be your mayor, I will do the due diligence I did to dismantle the red light cameras. They created more rear-end accidents than they prevented. So I will never do anything to promote myself at the expense of somebody else or at you, the public. I'm running because I believe there are things that we got done. Got rid of a visitor center that would have cost you tens of millions of dollars in terms of the debt load during the life of that bond, the fancy word amortization of that period. Certainly if you include the staffing, the operation, and maintenance, it would have been even more expensive. We didn't need it. We have, in the power of our pockets, visitor centers, their apps. That's what we need in the 21st century. So I won't do anybody's business at the expense of the public. That was really an effort to revitalize downtown at the expense of tens of millions of dollars to you. That's not appropriate. Some of the other things that I worked on in terms of Liberty is the Tim Cole Memorial, because I get passionate when I see government encroach upon people, particularly the weakest among us. And the bigger government gets, the weaker we all get. So in some ways, we're all becoming the least among us when it comes to federal government. But Tim Cole died in prison for a crime he didn't commit.
Sorry, we're going to have to move on to the next question.
And government's role is, go ahead.
If elected, what steps would you take to reduce the debt our city has accumulated?
You got it. I'll just finish this one sentence. The role of government is to, when we make a mistake, acknowledge it, seek to make amends, and work to avoid it in the future. That's what that memorial was about. And as far as debt goes, prudence and patience. About halfway through on water and sewer. So 62% of your debt is water and sewer. Raise your hand if you don't like to flush your commode or drink water. Well, then I think we're square on that issue. Give us a few more years, we'll get it paid off. But what we shouldn't do is add to the debt things that we don't need. We don't need a $800 million city hall. It's fancy, it certainly helps downtown, but it's not what you need, and it doesn't take care of the police station in the way that it was suggested. So we need integrity in the process, we need transparency, and we need public advocacy. Now, the issues that you will hear today are issues that I took up while I was still on the council. When I was on the council, I said before I left, if we can trust people to put us on the council, we can trust them to vote on this issue. It's not an emergency, it's not a core essential service. Unfortunately, I couldn't get my peer group to do that then and there. We may be too far down the road on that issue at this point in time, which is a gravest mistake. But we'll make the best of it, because if I'm your mayor, we'll have more public hearings on that issue going forward.
Great. And what is another important issue to you facing our city? And if elected mayor, how would you address it?
Yeah, I think there are a series of issues. Some of it's just simply taking care of business. Government should be quiet, right? I mean, one reason you're probably here, not just simply because you're civil libertarians, but because you're concerned about particular issues. So when governments run well, we don't have a lot of anger. We don't have a lot of crisis management. So one of the things that I bring to the table is a proactive ability to get things done. One of the things that I achieved while I was on the council, and we got a lot done because we were able to have a conversation beginning internally with my creator, my conscience, but it extended out to my constituents. I did about 50 town halls, which was unprecedented, and I didn't do them 30 minutes before you had to go to work. I did them on the weekends and in the evenings on Saturdays. So we need to do more of that kind of stuff. But some of the issues beyond that, certainly a city manager is a factor, but I'll tell you right now, it's taking essential services, first and foremost. Beyond that, it's just simply opening up the process. You ought to have more say on issues like tornado sirens, downtown, and how we spend your money. So one of the key aspects I'm saying regularly is, I want to focus on making sure that you have a more open government and more open say in how your affairs are managed and also how your money is spent. So that's kind of what I'm bringing to the table.
Very good. And if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging development of our city?
Well, again, I may differ with some of the remarks earlier, but that's okay. In a free society, we all have different views. I think we can walk and chew gum. I think that you do need your constitution, which is what your local charter is, updated, because it's not manageable. And that in and of itself is a crisis. But beyond that, your rights are given to you by your creator, not any government, and I'm not in a position to take them from you, nor should anybody else be. We need a two-thirds vote on issues like your eminent domain, issues like annexation. We've never de-annexed in the history of Lubbock. So that's as indelible as it gets. Once you're in, you're stuck. So we ought to have a much more open process, and we ought to have supermajority votes on those and public hearings as we move into it. Even if people want to get into the city, we ought to slowly discuss that, because there's an implication to you, the taxpayers. We can't work at cross purposes and say we want to redevelop downtown and then try to get as far up to Wolfert as we can. That just makes no sense. That's not spending your money wisely. It's not being honest with you. It's either you're not thinking through the issues or you're not being straight with the public. If you're not being straight with the public, it's a serious issue. It lacks integrity.
Very good. And which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners during times of drought?
Yeah, I think some of the things that we didn't get done, one of the reasons that I'm running, we need a more clear drinking water model. Does anybody know how we take care of your water rates? Anybody able to explain that? I used to say on the radio, I'll give $100 to the charity of your choice if you don't work in the water department, if you can explain it. I'd even open it up to my peers to call in if they'd like. I didn't say it like that, but I think it'd be a little bit too snarky. But nobody would call in because nobody understood it. The reason I understood it is because I thought it was a serious, gravest mistake what was going on. Right now, through September to February, we determine what your baseline is. So you can use as much water as possible. I've had city employees say to me, you know, councilman, honest truth is we spend about 13,000 gallons a month because we know the system. Now, at the pond household, we spend about 3,000 because we do flush and we do use water, but we don't do anything with landscaping. We can't really afford to, nor do we choose to. There's nothing right about a widow who's on a fixed income and not in our circumstance using 2,000 to 3,000 gallons and paying the same amount for somebody who's using 1,000 gallons a month more. That needs to be changed. So that would be certainly day one, something we begin to take up.
Great. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather disasters?
Well, I think it's your life. You've got skin in the game. I always find it very irritating when I hear from people with a lot of money that come before the council and say, you know, we've got skin in the game. Like you somehow don't. You know, you gotta be able to vote on tornado sirens. As I said, I don't need to tear anybody down. For this job, I'm happy to be a private citizen. Anybody that does that, I don't think is fit to be in this office. But I also don't want a job that doesn't pay, that might have blood on my hands. I said before I left the council, God forbid we have a tornado take place while we're dithering, missing publicly established dates to have reports back. Nobody seems to care. We're going through tornado seasons. Fortunately, we've gone through a couple more since those comments, and yet have any problems. But I don't want a tornado to strike. And somebody say, you know, what did the council do? Why didn't they pick it back? Why didn't they address that? I have enough things going on that I'm concerned about this community that keep me up at night. Your life is not going to be one of them. We're going to take that issue very serious. And as early, if I'm elected to be your mayor, as November, we'll have an election on that issue. And you can decide that issue.
Great. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
I think you're right. I think it's as little as possible. You know, I think ultimately the new model that we've got to be very much aware of that I talked about from the dais and from Market Street when I meet with folks wherever we do our town halls, is that the new paradigm is more of your money is going to go to Washington, D.C., and it's not going to go anywhere. It's going to go to largesse for cronyism, all these mistakes that they seem to do with this bloated government in D.C. But then you're going to see more unfunded mandates come down to you, and your council's going to have to address that. So we're going to have to do more to innovate. The choice shouldn't simply be we're going to raise your taxes or even that we're going to cut your services. We ought to innovate more. One of the things I did while I was on the council, it seemed like it was yeoman's work and wouldn't go anywhere, but I brought it forward anyway. And so against opposition of a couple council members, probably just because they didn't like me bringing forward yet another item, we were able to get the police chief and the sheriff to visit and get out of this issue as a result of Sonny Kazee and a former police chief having an argument back in what was at the 80s. All of a sudden we were doing jail detention. There's a moral liability that particularly bothers me. I don't want somebody getting hung in jail, or hanged, excuse me, in jail because we're in the wrong business. We're in law enforcement, not detention. And it cost us more money. And that manpower, those 8 to 11 positions could have been on the street. They're now on the street because, thank God, our sheriff and our police chief at the time came together and said, you know what, that should be changed. So we should innovate. Through shared services, we'll get a bigger bang for your buck. The role of government is to fill in the gaps that the private civic sector can't get the job done. We need more from the civic and faith-based and private sectors.
Thank you, Todd. And just a closing remark.
Well, I wound up spending one more time than I thought I would, so I'll be very quick. My website is toddrklein.com, and my Facebook is Todd Klein for Mayor. And then lastly, I'd like to say, that's my wife, Amanda. Thank you, my son, John. There's my mother, one of my cousins, Melissa. Thank you guys for being here, and thank you all. I look forward to visiting. My home number is 780-3000. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Last but not least, running for mayor, I'd like to introduce former county commissioner, local radio show host, and U.S. Army veteran, Ysidro Gutierrez. Ysidro, take a few minutes and tell us about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for mayor.
Thank you very much, Amanda. Well, I'm here to ask for all of your votes. And I'd like to begin by telling you that I am a veteran of the United States Army. I served 20 years in the Cold War. The people that served with me in Europe during the Cold War are responsible for keeping the Russians on their side of the border long enough for their system to collapse upon itself, and it did. I used to stand on the border with these giant binoculars, and I used to look at my Russian counterpart across the border about maybe 2 or 3 football fields away, and they'd have the same type of binocular looking back at me, and every now and then I could see their faces as clearly as I can see yours, and they would shout insults at me. Of course, I'd shout insults back at them too, and so they could see my face. So every way I think has been influenced by my 20 years of military service. It's a big sacrifice to serve the nation, ladies and gentlemen. It's a sacrifice to be away from home. And I served as commissioner for 4 years. I have accomplishments that I can point to as a member of the commissioner's court. For example, ending a $17 million giveaway to a local company that eventually went bankrupt. I was solely responsible for ending that. Building a dairy in Lubbock County, return of dairy production to Lubbock County after 25 years absence. As commissioner, I disagreed with my fellow commissioners all the time, but we were never disagreeable to each other. You'll never see on TV, radio, newspaper, or any rumors of any of the commissioners in the 4 year period that I was there being disagreeable with each other. So that's a little bit of who I am. I hope that you will vote for me, because I want to serve this community. My opponents say we need plans for Lubbock. I have a plan. And if you've heard my presentation before, you've seen my plan. I'm not proposing plans. I have a plan for the city of Lubbock to eliminate the debt, to change the city charter, to pay off, to end the hidden taxes. So this is the reason that I'm asking for your vote today.
Very good. And if elected, what steps would you take to reduce the debt our city has accumulated?
Very good. That is if you read the Legal Women Voters Guide, you will see my answer to that. I am proposing a one penny plan to begin to eliminate the debt. The one penny plan works this way. 1 cent out of every revenue dollar is taken every year, and it is dedicated to debt elimination and payoff. That is allowed by the city charter, the creation of a sinking fund. I also propose 10% of all new revenues from growth be dedicated to debt payoff. Those are specific plans that I have. So like I said at the beginning, I have a plan for that. My opponents say we need a plan, I have a plan. What we want to do is to begin to pay out the debt. Mr. Pope, I've heard him say 100 times, well, it's going to roll off pretty soon. 2034 is not pretty soon, Mr. Van Pope. It's not a few years, it's a long time. We've got $1.6 billion in debt. Cities half our size have gone bankrupt with that level of debt. And folks, when I say that to people, they get glassy-eyed. So I put it this way now. Every month, you are paid $11.7 million in debt service because of the irresponsible and foolish actions of previous city councils, which Todd Klein and Victor Hernandez were a part of.
Very good. And what is another one of the most important issues to you that faces your city? And if elected, how would you address it?
Another serious issue.
That you haven't already discussed.
Well, I would like to rewrite the city charter. Mr. Pope says we don't need to do that. That's a minor thing. Well, I propose that we do it, but not as a major push. Like, for example, I intend to take a hard line on paying off the debt. I intend to take a hard line on the hidden tax. But on the city charter, what I want to do is appoint a committee, and I want to give them 4 levels of instruction. First off, when you rewrite or amend the city charter, leave politics out of it. Leave special interests out of it. Keep what is good in the city charter that is serving the citizens well.
Very good. And since annexation of property outside the city limits is a very significant issue, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Well, folks, if you look at the demographics for Texas, Texas is growing, and every city in Texas is growing along with Texas. We've got people moving into our state from around the country, of course, natural birth, but we have immigration that is making Texas boom. Growth is inevitable. I like the compromise that was reached between the citizens of Lubbock and the city council and the committee recently. I think this is the reason for this question coming up. The grace period for those folks is a good thing. No one objects, but eventually the city of Lubbock is going to grow just like all of Texas is growing, just like all of the cities in Texas are growing. So if a citizen comes to me and says, well, can't you give me 20 years of grace period because I invested money and I've made all of this effort, I would agree with the rest of the members of the city council and say, why not a 20-year grace period? What's wrong with that? We can wait 20 years.
Very good. And do you believe in a supermajority vote of affirmation for the affected landowners or residents?
A supermajority vote?
Yes, that are affected by annexation.
Well, I have found that supermajority votes are very difficult. Normally what that is an obstacle. What's wrong with 50 plus 1? 50 plus 1 has served our nation very well. As a matter of fact, if you want to see obstruction in the supermajority concept, look at our Congress in Washington. I don't think that we'd get very much done if we did that. Even here in Austin, in our legislature, whenever we have supermajority requirements, it also is an obstacle to getting things done. We need to get things done in this city, and the way to do it is to work with the rest of the city council by being respectful of them, protecting their dignity, putting the benefits of the people of Lubbock at the forefront, getting the public involved, informing the media why and what we want to do, and I think that we can get things done. But you gotta respect your fellow members on the council, and you have to protect the dignity of those folks.
Very good. And which system of conservation, water conservation, do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners during times of drought?
Well, the conservation, of course, is essential, and we need to do it. There are people in the city of Lubbock that are already harvesting rain. They have systems in their home they're doing, but it's very few. I think that in times of drought, it is when people start saying, well, why don't we have more rain harvesting at the homes? But here's what I would do specifically. Specifically, my plan for the city of Lubbock is to go ahead and capture all of the runoff that happens in our city every time we have a heavy rain. That can be done in several ways. I know about 5 years ago, I think a gentleman named Adams was looking at moving and building a dam within the general vicinity of Lubbock County to capture water like that. What's wrong with that idea? It's a good idea. Let's do it. It will be a great way to preserve water. The recycling and reclamation of water works very well for communities all over the country. There's no reason why it couldn't work for us. Reclaimed water is safe to drink and safe to use as potable water. There's no reason why we couldn't do it. It would take a public education program to say to folks, well, do you want to water your lawn or would you rather not water your lawn? I think that the people of Lubbock would support water projects if they were explained to them properly.
Very good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management systems related to weather disasters?
Once again, I want to invite your attention to the Lubbock AJ tomorrow. I think there's going to be a voter's guide, but also the League of Women Voters guide has the same question. I was a member of the Red Cross for 5 years and a director of the Red Cross for a year. I know what we need, how the strategies for disaster abatement work. You have to be prepared, you have to mitigate, and then you have to recover. Those systems are proven strategies that have been used by the American Red Cross for over 100 years, and they serve the nation very well. And it's not a knee-jerk, let's buy equipment and put it in storage for the next snowstorm type of a concept. It is prudent, it is logical, it works, it's a strategy that we need to use because other people have proven over the last 100 years that it does work.
And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
I'm a member of the Constitutionalist Society of Lubbock. I am a charter member of the Constitutionalist Society of Lubbock. And we believe in the ideals and the founding principles that our founding fathers put into effect that has given us a nation, a great nation, that is great regardless of whether we need to make it great again or not. We're a great nation. In the founding documents, in the founding principles of the nation, with reliance on divine providence and with folks that were really devoted to the good of the people, we have a system where the federal government has their place. And the way the power structure is set up according to our constitution is the people rule, the states are second in line for rule, and the federal government is at the bottom of the governing pyramid. So, federal government should not be involved in education. Federal government should not be involved in any of the, you know, like city bus, for example, shouldn't have any federal involvement in that. That is overextending and based on the founding principles of our nation, which have served our nation very well.
And
if
we'll just make a final statement, 10 seconds, your time is up.
10 seconds. Well, you see this here, it says, Ysidro Gutierrez for mayor. If you type that on Google, it'll take you to my Facebook, and then you can see my whole platform. You see that poster right there? That's my philosophy. That's my philosophy of government.
Very good. Thank you so much, Ysidro. I appreciate it. And before I introduce our next candidate, I would like to ask if there are any candidates in the room that have come in a little bit late, if you'll raise your hand. I have an agenda to give you. You can also come up here to the front if you're able to do that. And that way you're ready to go. If you'll raise your hand if you're a candidate. Okay. Okay, in introducing our next candidate, if you are in the room, running for District 2, longtime Lubbock resident and former assistant administrator for LISD's alternative education program, Mr. Gordon Harris, are you here? No. We will move on to the next candidate, and I will introduce. Running for District 2, former U.S. Naval Service member, pastor, and neighborhood advocate, Christopher Stevone Moore. And are you in the room?
Yes.
I know I saw you. We're going to go through these same questions so I can get your perspective. So tell us first a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for District 2.
I am from Lubbock, Texas, born and raised in Lubbock, Texas.
had an opportunity after I graduated from Escala High School. I joined the military, joined the United States Navy, so served our country for 4 years. After that, I moved to Dallas, Texas. Went to Caribbean School in Computer Technology. Started a career at Greyhound Lines. Worked there for about 5 years, and then I was called back to the lovely city of Lubbock, Texas in 2002. It has that rubber band effect, and so I've been back 2002, pastor in the church by the name of Victory and Praise Christian Fellowship Church, where I served. And during my tenure, in regards to being here for 14 years, I have been involved in the community. I have adopted the nickname called the Connector. I have this gift of bringing people together, resources together to see some things happen in our city as well as in our district. Back in 2013, I put together a MLK citywide march and food drive that was very successful in doing such. And there's been some other opportunities that we've been able to do as well to bring the city and our community together. So I look forward to seeing this opportunity as using this opportunity as an opportunity to maximize our visibility, to continue to create a culture of unity, to bring people together to see some great things happen in District 2. What I believe that I bring to District 2 is what I call visionary leadership. For all of us, the whole entire city of Lubbock realizes that 50 years plus, that there has not been much activity, development, capital projects that have taken place in District 2. If you look at the Lubbock website and look and see their Lubbock development plan, you will still notice that most of the majority of capital projects are in northwest, southwest Lubbock. We can count on our hands the projects that are taking place in southeast, northeast, and central east Lubbock. So there's not much development that's taking place there. We want visionary leadership. We want someone like myself to
provide
representation. I got 10 seconds. Representation, communication, and demonstration that we can make some things happen in District 2.
Excellent, perfect. And if elected, what steps would you take to reduce our debt and our city has accumulated?
Well, looking at the budget, had an opportunity to look at the fiscal budget. What we do see within the budget is that we really have to. It's a matter of balance. It's a matter of what you got coming in and what you got going out. The net position for the city of Lubbock is $785 million. That's what we have to work with. The city of Lubbock has the different entities in which it places its budget, whether it be the activities, which is its expenses, LBNL, water, street, sewer, and all of those kinds of things. It has its general maintenance for those who are in the office that are always in the facilities. It has other entities. And what you find out in that budget, there are access funds that are still available for the city of Lubbock. Last year, the city of Lubbock had over $200 million. $200 million. And I like it because it's all in black and white. And that you can go to that page. And they can use those $200 million, and it says specifically at their discretion. So it's in one sector, it says that you can use a certain amount of millions of dollars in order to pay off the citizens as well as the debts that you owe. So I think it will be important that we take a look at the budget, take a look at the access funds that the leftovers that are being that are given over, and just like as some of the mayors that's running for the office of mayor said, is that why would we give $1 million to someone who can already help themselves? Why would we give our funding to business owners, to developers, to investors who already got big money? Why not project in regards to giving it to those or other developments that we're looking forward to so we can prevent annexation and develop some other areas like areas in District 2?
Very good. And what is one of the most important issues to you that faces your district? And if elected, how would you address it?
Well, economic development is definitely one of the top issues in our community. Again, for over 50 years, there has not been any development in that district when it comes down to central
Central, Southeast, and Northeast Lubbock. We see, we know that there are some projects that's on the planner as far as the Regis Park and even with the North and East Lubbock CDC. We see that the Mahon Villa is in a project. And what I like about the Mahon, and let me bring this up, when I think about the Mahon Villa, that project is part of the North and East Lubbock development. They did put together a revitalization plan. And with the revitalization plan, there's five projects that's involved with that. That revitalization budget is worth $43 million. What we have not seen in Central, East, Southeast, or Northeast levels is the revitalization plan. We talk about it, or we put it together, but we don't stay focused in regards to finding ways to finish up the projects. So again, we want to look and find out, listen, we want economic development. How do we tie Central East Lubbock to the city of Lubbock? We have been separated for over 50 years. How do we tie it in? So with the Mahon Villa, what they've done, they tied it into Texas Tech University. In 2020, they should have another 20, 30,000 students. They tied it into Overton Park. They tied it into the downtown Lubbock project. And with that all being said, we want to tie Mahon Villa and we can provide a budget in order to pull them in because we want the city to be whole. Well, the city will never be whole if East Lubbock is not included in that development and in that growth. So when it comes down to it, now, High Cotton is a great place. I believe the freeway used to go right down Avenue A. High Cotton is a grand location where we can tie East Lubbock, Central East Lubbock, District 2, into the development phase and the growth and development that's going on in the city of Lubbock. So when it comes down to what we're looking for the most is economic development. And I would like to say as well, we need equity. We want to be included. There's a disparity in equity. We want to be included, we want to be recognized, we want to be seen, we want to be heard, and that's why it's important that during this term of city council, we can't have somebody on city council that's going to be passive and let everything just ride, and for the next 50 years, nothing is being developed, nobody is saying nothing in regards to what's taking place in East Lubbock, so we want someone who's going to have representation.
So, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city? And this is related to the annexation.
Yeah, and as I've answered that in the past, I believe that it should be done on a case-by-case matter. When I've had an opportunity to sit in some of the annexation meetings, and there are some who agree with an annexation from the southwest area. There's some who don't want it. And so what we did, and this is interesting, is that the acres of land for this annexation would have been the largest annexation that would have ever taken place in the city of Lubbock. Usually when we do annexations, it's 100, 200, you know, acres of such. It's never 1,000, 1,200 acres. And so before the current city council and the mayor were being removed from the council board, they wanted to see, can we go ahead and get this so we don't deal with these new guys that's gonna be sitting on the panel to make these decisions. And if we can captivate the audience, if we can get this current city council and mayor to vote for this, then we don't have to deal with them later. It goes right with the economic development team that was there fighting from East Lubbock, saying, hey, we need something done in East Lubbock. Well, the mayor said to them, listen, we're gonna have a work session. You know what he planned that work session? 60 days later. That's interesting, because you gotta keep your ears open. You got to watch out for the smoke that's going on. Well, in 60 days, Mayor, guess what? You're not telling those guys, but you're not going to be in office no more. So we don't have to deal with that. So again, when you go with the annexation, it is important for growth. But I would say that there is land. If we're going to tie this city together, let's bring some balance. What's on the west side, let's make it on the east side. It can be something quite different. So we don't have a Nike outlet store, but we can have a Mervyn's outlet store. We need to create some opportunities that will attract people to move or come over to District 2 in order to gain services in that community.
Very good. And so for water usage during times of drought, that's always a major issue for every community. So which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
Well, I'll tell you what, the city of Lubbock, actually we saved over $5 million last year for water conservation. Okay, so it takes us as skin in the game, all of us being involved with that. When we see that there's a drought, we know, hey, we need to conserve water. So at my home, I have like, when my children are brushing their teeth, turn off that water, you know, or if they're taking a shower, you know, I limit those showers a little bit. But so with that being said, just little things like that has been a great asset in saving funds and with the water conservation. So small things will be important.
Very good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
Well, I'm just like Dan Pope. I think it's little as possible. I don't think you should ever have to have what I call a caretaker. We don't never want the government to rule over us. We don't want them to be able to. I think we have enough skills and talents and knowledge that we, as a state, we can govern our own state, and as a city, we can govern our own city. So I would say little as possible.
Very good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather disasters?
You know, I've been in foster care and other opportunities, and what you'll see in my home, I have a fire exit plan, or, you know, a tornado exit plan, or a hazard storm plan. The city of Lubbock didn't plan. And I don't think that you should go and spend millions, while we're already in debt, millions and millions of dollars on high-cost equipment when you have some sufficient equipment to do the job, and let it sit there for the next 50 years, because these storms don't come every day. So what we should do is prepare a plan. Well, what do we do with a storm? Because we've already experienced it. Why wouldn't we now, the next time a storm like that, we hear about it, well, that's the alarm. Let's go out for the main corridors and streets that lead to our hospitals and lead to different shelters and different things and things that we need. Let's go ahead and open up those corridors and make sure that those streets are cleaned off and ready to go so that we can have access to emergency shelters.
Excellent, excellent. And just a closing statement from you.
I tell you, I'm so excited. And I am very convicted about this opportunity to be city council for district number 2. I have the head, I have the heart, I have the pulse of the community, and I have the hands in order to get it done. So if you are part of district 2, I'm 4 in the ballot. So vote 4 for more. Appreciate your time. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. And I'd like to move on and introduce, running for District 2 as well, local business owner and community volunteer, Donald Ray Tiger Pratt. Goes by Tiger. Thank you. So first, just tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate.
Okay, good. Like I said, my name is Tiger Pratt, candidate for District 2. Basically, lifelong resident, moved away, lived in Dallas for a little bit, lived in Atlanta also for about 8 years, but I've actually been home about 14 years, and the majority of that 14 years lived in District 2. So what I really believe that makes me, the best candidate for the situation, not any no disrespect to anyone, but I really, 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 really do have a genuine interest and a genuine passion for seeing people succeed. That is the core foundation of all of this. Any politician, any civic leader, if that is not 90% of your heart, it makes me question, why are we in the business of doing that? So one, I do. I have a passion. My heart bleeds. My heart bleeds to see families and to see individuals reach their full potential and to see households succeed, their households succeed and reach the dreams that they have for their family. Second, I believe my background in business, my background dealing with the public, dealing with civic organizations. I know about commercial lending. I know about small business owners, the needs of small business owners. I know about creating home ownership for hundreds of thousands of people being in the banking business. I've worked with builders, I've worked with developers, I've worked with realtors. I've worked with in the essence of that scope of things, I think those experiences positions me to really, really, really be effective in bringing growth and development to the city of Lubbock as a whole, but even to District 2. I've worked with audits. I've worked with budgets. I've worked with compliance. In the banking field, compliance is everything. You know, you can't miss that. You have to deal with audits. So I think just that overall experience, that general experience, would make me really, really effective in District 2. So that's why I think.
Very good. And if elected, what steps do you think that you could take to reduce debt that our city is in?
Absolutely, absolutely. Our debt is $1.5 billion, as you guys know, outstanding city debt. Like everybody's been championing and saying, you know, those bonds are going to be paying off, I think. Somebody help me here. Next 3 more years.
2034.
Okay, 2034. Okay, wow. That far out. Okay, wow, I thought there was something that would be paying off in the next 4 or 5 years. But anyway, there are some bonds that are going to be maturing that I heard is going to take anywhere from 30 to 40% of that debt down. So that's the first step. The next thing that I would do, I would want the council to come together and let's begin to lay out the different approaches, the different proposals of how we can reduce the debt by another 30 to 40% over a 5 to 10 year period. Second, I would want to put a freeze on any budget increases for 5 years. Any budget increases, we would put a freeze on that for 5 years. The next thing that we would, let me go to my notes here. I actually have that down. 34, by letting current bonds mature and add an additional debt, put a freeze on increase in the budget for 5 years, look for creative ways to lower each department's budget by 7 to 10%. Now, I know we might say, okay, that might be pretty hard because that could be, you know, that's pretty hard. But that's what we can do across the board. If there's 15 different departments within the city government, let's go and let's take a look to see how can we reduce those budgets by 7 to 10%, but not getting the departments too lean to where they're not efficient or they lose their efficiency. Another thing that we can do is create a budget neutral approach across the board for 5 years. So I think a budget neutral approach means that anything that is being proposed, it's already being paid for, just for people who might not understand that, meaning it's neutral, meaning whatever we're going to spend, we've already found a way to pay for it. And usually the way they go about doing that is pulling from other areas of the budget in order to make that happen, or it's a self-sustaining, self-servicing mechanism, meaning that it pays for itself, whatever it is that we're doing. So I think if you bring those five things together, and we stick to that for a 5-year, 7-year plan, that is the way that we can actually reduce our debt even the more.
Excellent. And what is another important issue to you that faces your district? And if elected, how would you address it?
Okay, yes. One of the things that actually faces everybody in everybody's district, we already have laid out the vision. Lubbock has done a great job in laying out the vision. I mean, we have a Market Lubbock. Their vision is phenomenal. We have Imagine Lubbock. Their vision is phenomenal. We have the downtown development team. Their vision is phenomenal. So here it is, guys. The vision is already laid out. If you put all of those wonderful schemes or schematics, I think they call them more that vision, not schemes, but I meant to say schematics. The vision from each of these organizations that have come together, it's a beautiful plan. It takes Lubbock to the place that we all want to see. But here's the thing, across the board, where is the money going to come from in order to fund that? They have already laid out a beautiful vision of what Lubbock would look like if we had the money. So the issue really is, we just have to fund this now. The drawings have been made up for East Lubbock, for District 2, for downtown, it's already done. People have already done it. The only reason that stuff is not shoveled to the ground yet is because they have to come up with the money. So with District 2, it's the exact same thing. We have the vision, we see the plans, we see the needs, but how are we gonna come up with the money? So that's one of the things that I will be doing and putting in place, because I no longer want District 2 to be hinged in, meaning the growth and the development of District 2 to be hinged in by the vote of a 4. Because you have to have 4 votes to get any funding allocated. So the growth and the development of District 2 should not be stagnated or hinged in, because there are going to be times we're not going to be able to attain the 4 votes that we need. So the growth and development shouldn't be solely based on if we can obtain the 4 votes. Also, we don't want the growth of District 2 to be a growth and development of District 2 to be hinged in also by market conditions. Because I'm telling you, if there is a global recession, if there is a global recession, if there's a United States recession, if there's a market downturn, the revenue that the city brings in is going to be impacted by that. it's going to be impacted by that. So therefore, that means there's going to be less revenue dollars to allocate into the districts to bring about that development. So we have to begin to think, what are creative ways that we can do in order to generate our own revenue to be able to make those investments, to be able to bring that development that the district wants to see outside of solely tax revenue. So the plan that we put in place, it's called, you can go to tigerpratt.com, the plan, which is a non-taxpayer strategy, doesn't involve any taxpayer dollars, and it allows us to do that very thing.
All right, and we'll move on to the next question.
Yes.
So if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Absolutely, absolutely. Great question. Private property rights, I am a very, like I said, I am I'm an advocate for that, for private property rights, not just for homeowners, but also for even small business owners. So not for just homeowners, but also for small business owners. One, the first thing we do is that we follow the Constitution. It's really pretty simple. We follow the Constitution. It embodies the very laws that actually protect the private citizens in the area of homeowners and also in the area of business owners. Second, there are state laws already in place in the state of Texas that oversee and that protects the individuals. One, there's laws here locally. There's laws here locally that automatically do that very thing. It's just about getting the people in place who have the political will and the fortitude to take that stance and make sure that we're doing that. Another thing, when it comes to the annexation question, like I say, we are in a culture and we are in a climate where people want to grow in Lubbock, Texas. We want to grow, we want to build, we want to develop. So when you are in a culture that wants to grow, it's going to happen where you're going to have to actually acquire some land. But when we acquire that land, we need to make sure that we are doing it by the statutes and by the laws that are already in place, and not any of this, now I'll say, schemes. You know, not in any of these, you know, kind of backhanded backdoor deals and all that kind of stuff. It needs to be transparent, and we need to be treating the owners that are going to be affected by this with honesty, with integrity, and with absolute fairness, and doing what it is that we can do to make it a right thing when we actually have to do that.
Good. We have one more question for you. Time for one more question, as well as your closing statement.
Okay.
So I'd like to know, what level of involvement do you feel that the federal government should have on our city government?
Level federal, okay, gotcha. One, I don't object to what our founding fathers have put in place. The federal government is in place for a role, and I can't take, you know, our democracy has been in place, what is it? Jared, I know you know the answer to this.
Mm-hmm.
How long is it? Over a little bit over 200?
39.
Okay, 239 years?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so roughly that. Yeah, so I'm not gonna challenge that wisdom. I mean, I'm only 40-something years old. But I believe that our founding fathers did the right thing. There is a role and a place for federal government. And then also they built the structure to where then there is state level. You know what I'm saying? They're state level. So the role of federal government, let it do what it was meant to do. And I won't go into the areas of what they do, which a state cannot do. But I definitely believe that their role should be limited. But I'm okay with the structure that our founding fathers have put in place. So when they ask, you know, what's the role of federal government? Yeah, it should not have overreach. It should not be encroaching on the rights of states. If we voted that this is what we want in Texas, they shouldn't encroach on that. But the foundation and the structure of the government, we're the best nation on the planet. You know, so I'm okay with that.
Excellent. I think we have a little more.
Okay.
So what role do you believe that the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather disasters?
Okay, gotcha. What I think we should do, one, they definitely have a role. They definitely have a role, and that's a consensus. Everybody agrees that we didn't handle it right. We missed some opportunities to be able to serve the citizens of Lubbock pretty well. Like everybody is saying, no, we should not go out. We already have debt. We shouldn't be doing bonds in order to purchase heavy equipment. But I think there's some things that we can do. One, now that we know, let's make sure that we plan better. Two, let's make sure that we have contractors. I mean, Walmart, 7-Eleven, Stripes, they did it on their own. They went out and spent money and brought people in to the private sector, and they got it done. I mean, they got it done. So I think we would want to have contractors on board that are licensed, that are bonded, have experience in doing it, and when it comes down, we can look at actually hiring them on for that little period of time. But also, the second thing too, we have heavy equipment already, so why not, let's look at the cost and the feasibility of making them have dual roles, where we're putting harnesses on the front of these heavy equipment, and we go and purchase the shovel parts, you know, that are about the size of this thing here, and you can mount those to those trucks. even though they're not designed for that now, but we can spend some money to mount it to where we can actually put shovels on it, to where we're not having to contract out anybody, and we have vehicles that have dual roles and dual purposes, and that's saving money. So that's one of the things that I would, that's what I would do.
And then just a final statement for you.
Okay. Well, thank you. Pleasure being here. Once again, Tiger Pratt, running for District 2. On the ballot, fortunate to get number one, so I'm easy to find. So when you get to District 2, just circle that first name up there. But one, I love my city. I love my country. I love people. I want to see people succeed, but most importantly, I want to see our city succeed. I believe with the experiences that I've gone through over the last 42 years, I can actually contribute to that. One, from a holistic point of view, working with organizations, nonprofits, churches, civic, and then also being in the business community and working in banking and finance. I think with that combination, I think it sets me apart to where I can do some effective things and make our city exactly what it needs to be and for the families. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Time is up. Thank you so much. And then next, I'd like to introduce another candidate running for District 2, South Plains personal family lawyer, Jared B. Hall. Tell us a little bit about yourself and why you think you're the best candidate for District 2.
Okay, I'm Jared B. Hall. I'm running for City Council because I want to represent all of District 2. I want to ensure that those citizens get those basic city services that they are paying for and get them at a fair price. This is a diverse district that includes much more than the areas east of I-27. My wife, Sheila Gomez Hall, and I, we have friends all over this district. I know what the issues are, I know how to, and I know who is being affected by these issues. I'm an attorney in private practice for over 10 years. I've represented a diverse range of clients, all walks of life, and I know how to fight for my clients, I know how to get results, and I know how to bring those skills to the city council race. When the city is acting in a conservative, responsible, and reasonable manner, taking care of its primary job, that's the best form of economic growth. How can we talk about millions of dollars for revitalization when we are $1.2 billion in debt, when there's over 50 miles of unpaved roads in District 2? How can we talk about another development project when a lot of our citizens here in District 2 are facing skyrocketing crime? Just recently, really in the last couple of years, as we've seen an unsecured border south of us allowing the free flow of drugs to come north, and it really has affected our city. So I'm Jared B. Hall. I will be the reasonable, responsible, and conservative voice on this city council, and I'll be the one fighting against the next frivolous project. I'll be the one making sure your LP&L bill doesn't rise. I'll be the one making sure that your property taxes don't go up every year. I'll be the one working with the police to make sure our neighborhoods are safer. And I'll be the only one making sure that you get every penny's worth from your dollars. So I'm Jared B. Hall, and I'd like you to send Jared Hall to City Hall.
Very good. And if elected, what steps would you take to reduce our debt?
Okay, reducing our debt is actually kind of simple. First, really stop borrowing money. It really starts right there. You stop borrowing money, then the debt automatically reduces as we continue to pay off. Second one is, we've got to have a very sound strategy for growth in this city. Aggressive growth means the city of Lubbock gets, this year they're projecting something around $63 million in sales tax growth. That is entirely dependent on the growth of the city and the region. Lubbock has a great, it really puts in a policy of growth that attracts businesses to this area. Then we'll see an increase in sales tax revenue. We'll also see an increase in property tax revenue. So we're not having to come back to the citizens of Lubbock asking for another property tax increase or another sales tax increase.
Very good. And what is another important issue to you that faces your district? And if elected, how would you address it?
Okay, as I walk around the district and I'm knocking on doors and I'm talking to these residents, the number one thing that they want to talk to me about is crime. They have seen not only crime increase in their neighborhoods, but deterioration. And those kind of go hand in hand. With increased crime comes decreased property values. Decreased property values attract renters, I guess you could say. And then we have the properties aren't being taken care of. So crime is the number one issue. The second one is the city debt. And then the final issue that we see a lot of is jobs, which comes from encouraging the city growth.
Very good. And let's see. As far as annexation of property outside the city limits goes, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Okay, so annexation is a complex issue. I spent a couple hours talking with the planning and zoning board. We went over this issue. What we're looking at is annexation can be done for good reasons or it can be done for bad reasons. If it's done as part of a long-term growth plan, with protections for the property owners, with understanding that we're not trying to overburden our existing infrastructure, then it can be done for the right reasons. If it's done just solely to capture those high-value properties and increase the property tax base, then that's a bad reason. You have to understand that the city of Lubbock has to continue to grow. If we say we're no longer going to annex any further properties, we might as well shut the city down, because no more businesses are going to move here if they see that this is a city that's not committed to growth. So with that in mind, then we got to also remember we do need to protect these property owners. I think the deal that they have now is a good deal for them. They get 20 years. I'm reminded of the story of, what was it, Pecosville? Heard somebody moved 40 miles away, so he moved another 40 miles away. That's not an option anymore. You're never going to be away, so far away from your neighbors that no one's going to move next to you.
And which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business? And business owners during times of drought, specifically talking about water conservation.
I like the ideas of reclamation and then also capturing rainwater. So at my own house, I do both of those. I don't know if any of you, how many of you know this, but there's a specific provision in the Texas Water Code that allows you to use the gray water from your house to water your landscape. So I run my washing machine water out to water my lawn. Hey, I paid for that water, I'm gonna use it. I'm gonna use every drop of it, okay? Then rainwater, I have set up several planters in my backyard, and the rainwater that comes off of my roofs, they divert into those planters. So I'm watering those plants without using additional water. So the city needs to do work more on that. Number one, let people know that you can capture some of that water that you're already using in your house instead of sending it down the sewer. Then number two, I like the idea of City of Austin. They provide the residents there, I believe it's a $500 credit if they install a rainwater capture system. The other thing is I don't know if all of y'all know this, but if you do install a rainwater capture system, you are entitled to purchase those items sales tax free. That's in the Texas code as well.
Very good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
As little as possible. I mean, that's kind of the standard answer, but one thing that I was thinking about when you brought this question was, we have an interesting dynamic in this country here, where we're seeing a federal government that's ignoring enforcing the laws. And that will cause a trickle-down effect. We may see cities and states deciding to ignore the federal government. So the federal government needs to do its job, and the states need to do a better job of protecting their citizens. If everybody's doing their job, then we don't really have these issues.
Very good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to water, weather disasters?
Well, as we were talking about the Goliath there, we needed to have a better plan in place to enlist the local citizens. The idea that we need snow plows is really silly. This is a once in a 30-year event, okay? Me, personally, I stocked up and I sat in my house for 3 days. I made the choice and I understood. Well, I'm from up north, I'm from Idaho. I know what happens when it snows. There's no reason for you to go out when it snows. You've got to give the city and the county the opportunity to clear those roads instead of going out there and packing them down. Okay, but, you know, people, I don't know. But one thing I did say is, so I managed to make it out of town on Tuesday because I was headed down to Houston to the Tech Bowl game. And what did I see on the way down there, coming out of Abilene? It was a snow plow. Well, why wasn't that snow plow in place before the storm? So we needed to have a better plan of enlisting the surrounding counties that weren't affected, the ones to the south and the east of us, and have their equipment on hand to help us deal with this issue as well.
Very good. And you just have a couple minutes left if you want to add something or make your closing statements.
Okay, well, I'm Jared B. Hall. I'm running for City Council to represent all of District 2. I intend to be that conservative, responsible, and reasonable voice on the City Council to ensure that we get a handle on our property taxes, that our LP&L bills don't go up, that we begin to reduce our debt, and that we are also providing those basic city services to all the residents of District 2 at a fair price. I need your vote, and so I'm asking you once again to send Jared B. Hall to City Hall.
Introduce the next candidate. He is running for District 4, local church pastor, as well as District 4 incumbent, Councilman Jim Gerlt. First, tell us a little bit about yourself. yourself and why you think you're the best candidate.
Okay. For 45 years, I have been heading up nonprofit or for-purpose groups, depending upon how you want to identify them, that have structures similar to our city government. Please excuse me, I'm recovering from walking pneumonia, so I'm kind of, my voice is not as strong as I would like for it to be right now. Poor Steve has had to sit by me through two forums during this time. I've had to be very careful not to breathe what I'm breathing, but, so I apologize for that. But for 45 years, headed up churches where we've had similar structure, where I have to prepare budgets, have to live within that mean, have to deal with personnel, have to hire and fire personnel, and give direction to my employers, because every member of the church is my employer. On city level, you give direction to the electorate, you are my employers. One of the things I think has been kind of overlooked in this process is the size of our budget. We talk about small businesses. Well, last year I presided over a budget, an income of $1.7 million. A lot of businesses in town don't take in $1.7 million in a year. So I've got experience, 45 years of experience, providing leadership in a positive way, fiscally conservative way of doing that. The last 4 years I've actually been on the city council, been a voice of reason, I think, on the council, helped bring reconciliation. When I went on the council 4 years ago, it was extremely dysfunctional. City manager had filed a complaint against one of our city council members. We had to walk through that. That was unprecedented. Weren't sure how to deal with that. We walked through that. Got resolution to that. Also, 4 years ago, the Electric Utility Board and the city council were just like this. And our LP&L board was determined that we were going to build a $750 million generating plant that would only work part-time. Well, we walked through that. We worked through that. Now we have the LP&L board, or EUB, and the city council working in harmony, and we're doing the right thing and heading toward ERCOT. So I've got that experience bringing in. I've got 4 years of institutional knowledge. And 2 years ago, my colleagues recognized my leadership ability and selected me to be the mayor pro tem. So there have been several times throughout the last 2 years where I've actually been the mayor when the mayor was out of town. So I bring a depth of experience working personal relationships to the table.
Very good. And I know that you've been working on this since you are a city councilman. But what steps do you think that we can continue to take to reduce debt that our city keeps accumulating?
Sure. Well, I'm happy to report to you that up until 4 years ago, debt was being piled on. The last 4 years, we've stopped that. We've held the debt level. I'm happy to report to you that this year we will pay down $89.5 million worth of debt. We have issued some new debt recently. You need to understand part of that is refinancing old debt. We're buying down some more higher paying bonds with more paying bonds. That's going to save the city of all the millions of dollars over the next several years. But one of the things we've done also is work to maintain as low taxes as possible while dealing with aging infrastructure, dealing with deferred maintenance, and all these things are taking place. And part of what we've had in the past has been creative financing that's helped build to our debt. Because there wasn't strong enough tax base to take care of street maintenance, for example, we've been bond funding that. Folks, that's stupid. The bond fund, basic street repair. That should not take place. I'm happy to report to you that through an amendment that I offered a year ago in the budgeting cycle, we're now cash funding about 80% of our street maintenance this year. Only 20% is going to be bond funded. It needs to be 100%, but we're making progress. 4 years ago, street maintenance was in the stormwater system. That's not where it needs to be. It's now in the general budget. So we're working on getting things back in line, but we stopped piling on debt by reducing our franchise fee. And we took it off the franchise fee and put it on property tax. Not deductible here, is deductible here. But one of the things that enabled us to do, we're not transferring as much money out of the water department, for example. Therefore, we were able to cash fund $1.6 million in capital projects instead of bond funding that. So again, cash instead of bond funding. We've also been able to lower the base rate on water meters. 4 years ago when I went on the council, the lowest base rate on a water meter was $28. It's now $16. So that's $12 a month that we're not taking out of your pocket. Now we've adjusted the rate on the water consumption a little bit to encourage conservation, but you have more of control over what your water rate is than what you had 4 years ago. Because we lowered the franchise fees, we're able to cash fund $400,000 worth of vehicles purchased this year instead of putting those on credit card. So we're already working on it, and we're working very hard. We've stopped piling on debt.
We've put a little bit, issued a little bit here on the citizen tower, but we've stopped that rapid advancement. We're actually starting to pay it down. So we're working on that hard.
Very good. And tell us about another important issue facing the city or your district. And if elected, how are you going to address it?
Well, some biggest issue is going to be the hiring of the city manager. That affects not only my district, that affects all city level. So we're already working on that. Been meeting with some of the head owners. We're doing a nationwide search for a city manager. We've already started meeting about that. So the new council, when the new council is seated, will continue that work and move forward. But it's absolutely essential that we get a quality city manager who can continue to lead our government forward, our city government forward. In District 4, one of the big things is our rapid growth. I don't know if it's an unparalleled expansion, but I'll tell you, we've got great expansion taking place in District 4. So making sure the infrastructure is in place in there, but I think one of the biggest things is keeping city government out of the way and allowing our developers to continue to move in District 4 to continue to develop the way that it needs to develop without a lot of city interference.
Very good, and I know that y'all have been addressing this as well. If elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging development in the city?
As you know, we've got this annexation taking place right now. We've had an option. There's an article, chapter 212 in the state government charter that allows an annexation to allow this chapter 212 in which a property owner can request not to be annexed up to a certain length of time. There's also chapter 43, that's an agriculture exempted. That's not an option. That has to be offered whenever annexation takes place. This annexation is different from the other annexations we've had while I've been on the council. The other annexations have been voluntary. They've come and requested us to annex them. This one is more the involuntary annexation. We've got several homeowners in there who really did not want to be included in that. We had three options. One was to ignore them and annex it all, or four options, I guess. Two is to not annex anything. Three is to carve out those sections and not include that in the annexation program. And the fourth one is to do the chapter 212. I have, and have it on my desk, in case I have to use it at the next council session, a survey that allows to carve out those sections and not include them in the annexation. But if my council votes again to approve the 212, and it takes two readings, we passed it the first time, and I believe it'll pass the second time. If we do that, then those folks who are already established, they've got their own water well, they've got their own septic tank, they've got everything they need and don't really want to be annexed right now, they could be left out of that. Now that's not the best way to do it because that kind of has a Swiss cheese approach to it. And for our first responders, a little bit of challenge over in the city, we're out of the city. I understand that. But I also understand property rights and I respect those property rights. And so that's why I supported the 212 to leave them out of the annexation for 20 years. My opinion is they will want to be annexed before 20 years have passed. I think they're going to want our city watered. Or else I think the property value is going to go up so much that they'll want to be annexed in the city and then they'll sell it. But I respect the property rights.
Very good. And in terms of water usage during times of drought, which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
Well, during times of drought, I know capturing rainwater and everything else, that's something we need to be doing all the time. When a drought comes, it's hard to implement drastic changes all at once. So going to our water restriction during that period of time is something that we just absolutely have to do. Now I will tell you, I've been encouraging our stormwater department to come up with incentives for people to capture their rainwater. On this, when we voted to change the stormwater fees, which I voted against, the mayor and I saw a train wreck coming on that and voted against it, but it got passed anyway. So that's been harmful to a lot of folks. Well, as we're revising that, I'm encouraging the stormwater department to come up with a plan for people like Tent City, for example, who has a vast amount of runoff, a lot of impervious surface, but they also have a lot of land down there. If they could develop systems for capturing that runoff, then we need to reward them for doing it and incentivize them to do that. I think we do that not just for like Tent City, but for anybody who can come up with a system for capturing the runoff and then use that during times of drought for irrigation and things. I think it's a very positive thing. We do have a tiered system on charging for water. The more water you use, the more expensive it gets, which only makes sense when you're in a desert area. A few years ago, it was the more water you use, the cheaper it got. Well, that doesn't make sense when you're trying to encourage water conservation. So we put steps in place to try to encourage conservation without making it so detrimental that you can't live and do business.
Good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
zero. Ideally, that's not realistic. But while we fight with the city, with the feds, we fight with the state. I made several trips to Austin, appealed before the Railroad Commission, and appeared before the state legislature, trying to get them to allow us to continue to have more say over things like gas rates, the Atmos gas. There's going to be a, you need to watch in your Atmos gas bill, there's a notice in there, they've done a grip filing, there's going to be a rate increase, and the city of Lubbock can do absolutely nothing about that. Now that's state, not federal, but I've made several trips to Austin and fought with them to try and maintain local control over setting the rates on gas. And we've been losing that. Feds, the Department of Justice brought a lawsuit against us for our police department. I really wanted to fight that, but at some point, they've got a printing press, they can print as much money as they want. We don't have that, you and I will pay that if we fight them. So we've negotiated what I think is the most reasonable agreement in it, but I'm not a big fan of federal intervention. I am not a big fan of federal intervention.
Good, and you just got a last statement for everyone, and that's it, closing statement.
Okay, well thank you for, man, what a fun way to spend a Saturday morning. I've come down here and listen to a bunch of politicians talk. But thank you for your interest and your involvement in our city. I am running for re-election. I feel like I've served admirably the last 4 years. I've walked the city through turbulent times, and we've got the city on a very solid footing now. When you look at all the accolades that are being poured upon the city of Lubbock, when you look at the Monsanto coming here, that was a 2-year process to get Monsanto here. It ended up with council members meeting them and assuring them that we'll support you coming here. Other multinational corporations are looking, they're gonna see what happens on the city council. If there's a drastic turnover on members of the council, they're gonna kind of sit back and watch a little while to see what happens. I can provide continuity. I bring continuity to the council. I bring 4 years of institutional knowledge that, man, you get on the council, there's a steep learning curve. I've already climbed that curve. So I bring continuity to the council, have the ability to work with all people and to keep our city moving forward. I'm Jim Gerlt. I'm number one on the ballot, number one in your hearts.
All right, and I'd like to introduce the next candidate. Yes, sir. Right, I'm going to introduce our next candidate, running for District 4 as well, local president and CEO of Advanced Graphics, and also community leader, Steve Massengale.
Thank you very much. My honor to be with you here today. I grew up here in Lubbock, went to Monterey, graduated from Texas Tech. My wife grew up here too, she went to Monterey. Went to Texas Tech. We have a 13-year-old daughter that attends Hutch Middle School, and we're very proud of her. She turned 13 last week, so I was telling Michael and Dina that it's been a learning curve for us. Teenager.
What makes you the best candidate?
Oh, I'm not done yet.
Okay.
Hang on.
Go ahead.
I'm a small business owner here in town. I've been a small business owner for over 30 years. We own a company called Advanced Graphics, and we also own the Matador, which is a retailer for Texas Tech. We're the official retailer for Texas Tech Athletics, and we're proud of that. I've had the opportunity to serve in many capacities in our community, from United Way to South Plains Association of Governments, Boy Scouts of America, but I also was elected in 06 to serve on the Lubbock School Board, where the only alternative when I was elected was to raise taxes and decided to work hard to find a way not to do that, and we made that government smaller. We were able to serve students better, which is the number one priority of that board. We were able to value our employees, which is important when you govern a large organization. And we were able to reduce costly facilities that save taxpayers money. We closed or consolidated 10 campuses. And I'm proud to say that we did that over an 8-year period, and I've never raised taxes. With my private and my public experience, it makes me the most qualified to serve the city council in District 4.
Very good. And what steps can you take to address our debt?
Well, I think the first thing we would do is try to avoid the headline we saw this morning in the newspaper. Wouldn't you agree, Michael?
No.
I've never had it.
Yeah. So everyone's right. The simple thing is to avoid, you don't add on any more debt. And you have to understand that this current council has added debt and raised your taxes. Isn't that what we're here to avoid? We have almost an $800 million budget. And we continue to borrow money for routine items like computers. Let me tell you, a computer in a small business is an expense. It is not an asset. City governments ought to be able to buy vehicles. And if you can't pay cash, then maybe we need to wait to buy them. We need to be able to pay for our roads with cash. And to me, it should be very difficult to make good business decisions in an $800 million budget to find ways to fund those items in cash. And that's how you solve the debt problem. You stop adding to it, like we did today.
Very good. And what's another important issue to you that faces the city or your district, and if elected, how would you address it?
I think the biggest impact the new council can have will be hiring the new city manager. I can't tell you how vitally important this is going to be, and I understand this process because I've hired and conducted nationwide searches for superintendents. I've hired two superintendents, as a matter of fact, while I was on the school board. But you see, we have a reputation right now as a city for being divisive, and we have been for the past many years. And people all across this state understand that. They know about Lubbock because the council is divisive. They also know that they fire their management. When you get a reputation like that, you can't attract the best and the brightest, which is what we need, conservative management to run our city government. We need to have expectations to bring somebody in that's not looking for a job. I don't want the individual looking for a job because they're already unemployed. I want the individual that's already doing has stellar performance in their current position to come in here and run our city government, and that's the start to savings. That's the start to reducing debt. That's the start to creating a responsive government so builders and developers who are trying to invest private dollars aren't waiting on bureaucracies to process their permits. That's crazy. It's crazy. City manager has to be hired.
And pertaining to annexation of property outside city limits, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging development in the city?
Okay. So I think annexation is necessary for growing a city. I'm a market economy kind of guy. I believe the market prevails, and if we're going to grow that market, and as we grow that market, that builds tax base, we're going to have to annex. But we need to make sure that we have a methodical plan and we stick to it. Our comprehensive land use plan, I currently serve on the Planning and Zoning Commission, has not been updated since 1984. Too many councils have kicked that can down the road, okay? We've got to have a plan. And then once we have a plan, we need to go ahead and follow through with what we've committed to. We have areas we've annexed that we haven't delivered services to. I got a call from a constituent, not District 4, but a citizen that says, I got annexed in 1994 and I still don't have my fire plugs. Why are we doing things like that? We've got to take care of what we've already committed to. We've got to communicate clearly. The other thing is, it is in all areas of government. I operate under the philosophy of no surprises. I'm going to do everything I can not to surprise you. I'm not going to surprise you with a building purchase. I'm not going to surprise you with, you know, I'm going to communicate clearly so that you have all the facts, and so that especially on major projects that you're included. But we shouldn't surprise these folks when we're annexing them. They should know 5 to 10 years out. I mean, we can all sit around a map in this room without consultants, and in a couple hours, we can all figure out what we're going to annex. Can't we, Mr. Miller?
Yes, sir.
We don't need a consultant to figure all that out.
No, sir.
And then we should be able to communicate to people. You know what? We think we're headed your direction. We think this is in the best interest of the city.
And addressing water usage during times of drought, what kind of system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and businesses?
You know, Regarding conservation, I think education is what's key. You know, I think we've got to continue to communicate. We've made some strides with conservation, but we're never going to not hear about conservation from here on out. We live in that world. We actually have a pretty good water plan for city government. We're fortunate. I promise you, there's cities east of I-35 that are jealous of us. But we're going to have to talk about recapture. We're going to have to talk about, and this is where education comes in, treating tertiary water. And it's already been mentioned here, but it's the world we're going to live in. We're going to have to treat sewer water, folks. But that's a conservative way to approach it, because we believe in taking care of the water we already have. And so I think we continue to educate our communities, not necessarily behind the curve on that, but we're going to have to keep growing our efforts. And we're going to have to continue as a city government to build into our water plan if we're going to maintain the good strategic water plan we have today.
Very good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
Yeah, I think everyone's going to has agreed up here, but I think when it comes to federal government, I'm a big advocate of local control, okay? Because we see what's going on, and I feel a little helpless. I don't know if anyone else feels a little helpless in here about the federal government, what's going on politically. It's hard to have an impact. But we can all in this room have an impact right here. Because you can call me if I'm elected, and I can get your opinion, and we can make a difference. So I've dealt with federal funds on the school district. Feds will meet with you, and they'll say, hey, we got some money for you. Like, hey, that's pretty cool. And guess what comes with federal money? Strings. And so you get wrapped up in all this, and they build the strings in, the rules in more, and then you figure out that you're growing government and you're not serving students in regards to the school district. So I'm very cautious about all of that. I'm always going to err on the side of local control. You know, I think local government needs to be really good at a few basic core services. I wish our federal government could be that too.
Very good. And just a closing statement for you.
I'm Steve Massengale. Again, I'm honored to be with you this morning. You know, I come to you today as the only candidate running in District 4 that's never raised taxes and had the authority to do so. I also come to you with more business experience. And there's, you know, my opponent is my friend, and I respect him, but there is a distinct difference in running a nonprofit and running a for-profit business that pays taxes, that operates in a free market competitive environment. I've made good decisions, and I've made bad decisions. And I've learned from those bad decisions, and that gives me the experience and the inventory to serve you well on the city council. I'll take that experience, and I'll make conservative decisions. I'll keep your taxes low. We're going to work on the debt. We're going to bust that down. And I'm excited and honored. I'd be honored to have your vote. And I'm also going to tell you I'm going to be excited to serve as your next councilman for District 4.
All right, and we're going to move on to another race. Running for District 1 special election, Army veteran and long-term resident of District 1, Frank Gutierrez. You'll come up here. Just a reminder, as it's coming up here, we will have this video recorded, and it will be out this coming week. So I will send that out to all the candidates, and that way that you can actually forward that on to some of your potential supporters. So tell us a little bit about yourself and why you think you're the best candidate.
There are no best candidates. It's a matter of what you've done in the communities, what you bring to the table of the Lubbock City Council. I bring a track record of working with all sectors of the community. I bring a track record of having worked in the community to bring about these changes that others speak of. I have the ability to be able to reach out to all sectors of the community, and my record supports that.
I am a founding charter member of Rise Academy in East Lubbock. And it is those principles that we've used to bring about a very successful school. It's those principles that I will use on the Lubbock City Council. One of the first things that we're going to do as far as the debt is concerned is we're going to cut those credit cards, just like we do with our home budget. And we're also going to emphasize the importance of personal responsibility at all levels of government. Having said that, I'm anticipating your next question.
Okay, very good. If elected, what steps would you take to reduce our debt?
As I mentioned, I feel strongly about the personal responsibility aspect of local government and at all levels. And what I mean by that is, if you know that a certain action is not going to benefit the community, then don't do it. At the school that I just mentioned, we have this philosophy that if any expenditures do not directly affect the needs of the children, then we don't do it. We don't have any extravagant expenditures. We don't have any amenities. The board does not have any perks. And we don't need them because we serve because we care about the students. And that's the same kind of mentality that I will bring to the Lubbock City Council, where we care about our constituents, where we care about the folks that we serve, and where we truly want to deliver on what's important for this community.
And what is another important issue to you that you believe is facing the city or district? And if elected, how would you address it?
There's, all the candidates, of course, we care about Lubbock. But District 1 is unique. District 1 is somehow, it seems, neglected. I think that most of you would agree with that. And at a time when we're re-annexing, I feel that that part of town, with some effort, can be upgraded. And here's what I mean. There in the Mahon-Jackson area, there is a sector of the community that just comes light. And here we are talking about annexing and bringing in more responsibilities when we haven't taken care of the core of these neighborhoods. That is why I will be in a better position to be able to address those issues, because I have received the support of some groups that are involved in such endeavors. One being the Lubbock Apartment Owners Association, Lubbock Board of Realtors, as well as the West Texas Home Builders. Those folks are the ones we need to be talking to in order to bring about these things in East Lubbock. Those are the folks that we need to be talking to in order to bring about more affordable housing in District 1, especially in the Jackson area. For folks that aren't familiar with that area, they used to be called the Barrio Nuevo, the new neighborhood. It's not so reflective of that right now, but folks still live there, and they have great needs, and those needs are best met with someone that has worked closely in the community and can reach out to all sectors of that community.
Very good. And pertaining to annexation of property rights or property outside the city limits, how would you protect property rights while still encouraging development of our city?
In order for the growth to continue, annexation has to happen. For example, the most recent annexation, that's a done deal. But as I've gone in the community and seen the concerns of folks, I'm not so sure that annexation or continued annexation is necessary if we haven't taken care of the central needs of the community. Over to the area, the Guadalupe area, all the parks in the area are somehow needing and neglected. Why? Is it because of the representation? Is it because of the failure of those responsible to deliver on those services? It's a failure of us not to expect the best from local government.
Good, and pertaining to water usage during times of drought, which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
personal responsibility first and foremost, because that means that you conserve what you have. We're in the middle of a desert back in when this part of the country was being annexed. It was called the Great American Desert. But we're in a desert, essentially. But we could use measures such as conservation. We could also use measures such as something that's very popular in Albuquerque, for example, that's xeriscaping. And maybe not, I'm not pronouncing that right, but what that means is you don't plant green stuff. That way you don't need to water it. Also, there's a lack of code enforcement as far as the watering is concerned, because we see too much waste.
Very good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather disasters?
The most recent blizzard is an example of lack of preparation, lack of heeding the warnings about the inclement weather that was forthcoming. Many of us prepared. Many of us went out and got groceries, but it doesn't seem that the city took it to heart. And without wanting to point fingers at the management aspect of the city, I think that maybe they weren't as involved as they should have been. So that in the future, any and all different agencies need to be in agreement with how to handle such a weather related emergency, because folks were housebound. They couldn't get out. Over there in the Marshall Sharp Freeway in Hernandez and neighborhood, we were having to deal with the inability to go anywhere. And that's an example of the failure of local government to properly address those matters before they happen.
Very good. In the last few seconds for the last question, as well as your closing statements, what level of involvement do you believe the federal government should have on our city government?
We have it to the extent that's necessary, because let me give you an example. If it weren't for the federal government, we wouldn't have funds to be able to dole out under projects such as the North and East Lubbock Development Corporation. The city would not have funds to be able to address the concerns of the Boys Clubs or any of the groups that are in love with serving the needs of children. So we need to have federal government to provide their funds as much as possible to be able to address those needs. However, when it comes to the strings attached, I feel that that is overreach, and that there are some matters that are best left up to local government, and that federal government needs to stay where it's at. That's why the national campaigns are having such a wonderful time in getting our attention about the failure of government at that level. And we've seen an example here at the local level where we have a high debt. We have a failure of being able to meet the basic needs of the community. And we also have a failure of paying attention to all sectors of the city. That's a concern, because as the growth continues south, we continue to deal with the empty lots over here in East Lubbock. And now in the area around Jackson, Mahon, that is also something that needs to be addressed, because those folks have very few options as to where to go to find affordable housing.
Very good. Your time is up, but just a quick closing statement for you.
Frank Gutierrez, I am a lifelong Lubbock resident, born and raised, attended Lubbock schools all my life, attended the university here after having served a tour of duty in the United States Army with a tour in Vietnam. I earned GI Bill benefits to go to Texas Tech and graduate from Texas Tech. Currently serve on the Board of Community Development. And as I mentioned before, I'm very proud to say that I'm a founding charter board member of Rise Academy. Those are the approaches that I will use as a member of the Lubbock City Council. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a pleasure.
Next candidate running for District 1 as well, special election, patient support representative Ben Medina. Come on up, Ben.
much in the office.
And tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate for District 1.
Okay, well, number one, thank you all for being here. I know it's very disheartening as active members of the political system when you don't feel like there's enough involvement. I want you to know that each and every one of you here, your presence here, it touches me and it makes me proud to be from Lubbock. What I feel is going to hold me in good stead in my service in the council is my long experience. I have 13 years experience working for Health and Human Services Commission. That's basically the food and food stamp and Medicare office. I left that agency in 2010. Spent a couple of years doing the super dad gig, and now I'm back in the workforce in the private sector. I'm doing related work. I help patients apply for Medicaid when they come to the hospital as self-pay patients.
Very good. And if elected, what steps would you take to help reduce the debt our city has accumulated?
Well, first and foremost would be, of course, to curtail spending. That's the most obvious solution to debt. When you're in debt, you look at what you're spending, and you try to spend the least amount possible based on your needs. And of course, obviously, you're going to try to reduce further debt. Basically, just looking at those things, I mean, just basic. Reduce your spending, reduce new debt, and budget as well as you can.
Good. What's another important issue to you that you believe faces your district, and if elected, how would you address it?
I think that the biggest issue facing the district, there are certainly issues within the neighborhood as far as affordable housing and the like, but I think the biggest issue facing the district is downtown. Given its proximity to District 1, it really does function as a gateway into the district. I think if anything is good for downtown, it would be good for the rest of the district. If you can get people downtown for whatever reason, they'll have cause to stop at businesses within the district, which will benefit the district altogether.
Very good. And pertaining to annexation of property outside the city limits, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Protecting property rights is, of course, an important consideration. You gotta weigh property rights with benefits already being received. People that live outside the city district, the city limits, when they get up in the morning and go to work, they probably do that in the city. The road that they drive on to get to work probably maintained by the city. If their house were to catch fire, they would call the Lubbock Fire Department. If their families were in danger, they probably, most likely, they might call the sheriff's office, but also LPD might be involved as well. Most likely, their children go to school in the city. So in many ways, people that live outside the city limits enjoy the benefits and the amenities of city life. And I think that it's fair to consider their property rights in light of that.
Good. And pertaining to water usage during times of drought, which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
Given that water is essential not only to life but our community here, every single method of conservation should be utilized. Everyone. We really don't have water to spare here. The Ogallala continues to decline. Despite the efforts and the money spent for Lake Allen Henry, and I think that's a great need, obviously, but ultimately water is a finite resource. Every consideration, every conservation effort should be made. I think code enforcement is an important aspect of that, but that falls on us. When we see our neighbor watered at inappropriate times, you know what? That shouldn't make us feel bad. We all need that water. We shouldn't feel bad about calling codes. When we see, especially a business, and I would like to point out, a lot of times Texas Tech University, unfortunately, seems to not take care with the water, that it uses a great deal of within the district. Water runoff from businesses, those things should be reported to code enforcement immediately. and of course within our own homes, just be careful, be safe. I would like for Lubbock to be a showcase of conservation for the entire nation. We know how to do things well in Lubbock, we know how to do things that make sense in Lubbock, and I think we can approach that issue with just common sense. Let's take care of what we have.
Good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather services or weather disasters?
Okay. Well, I know that that's an issue that comes up at every single forum, and I think it's the Goliath that's in the room is the village, I think. And the consensus is that there was lack of leadership, that both city managers, the city manager and the assistant city manager, were outside of town. In my own job, they require us to stagger our lunches so that there's always somebody there to answer the phone, there's always somebody there to take a customer. With the amount of money that we're paying the city manager and the assistant city manager, it would seem like a simple requirement would be you don't get to be on vacation at the same time. There always has to be somebody here. I think that, in all honesty, was a lack of leadership and oversight by council. That nobody on the council said, hey, is it a good idea to have two city managers outside of town? Not just in lieu of an upcoming crisis, but in general. For the amount of money that we're spending, there should always be a city manager available every single day. And it shouldn't be too hard to do. So I think that was simply a lack of oversight and supervision on part of the council.
Good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
I'm sorry.
What level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
The level of influence that the feds have over local government is the level that we allow them to have. You know, we talk about strings attached to federal money. Texas certainly is not doesn't have a problem rejecting federal money. We saw that most recently. There is an everyday effect to that. I see that in my job every day. New Mexico certainly took the expanded funds and expanded their Medicaid coverage. Texas did not. If you're a self-pay patient and you are a resident in the state of Texas, you're going to have a hard time. If you are a self-pay patient and you live in New Mexico, you're going to have a little bit of an easier time. That was the purview of our governor and state legislature. New Mexico made a different choice. So the amount of money that we take directly is proportional to the amount of influence that the feds have. We talk about strings attached as if though that was some outlandish idea. How many of you would give money to somebody without strings attached? Who gets money without strings attached? If you don't want the strings attached, don't take the money.
Good. And just a quick closing statement.
My name is Ben Medina. I'll be number one on the ballot for City Council District 1. Like I say, I believe what best qualifies me to be on council is my experience administering government benefits, the reality of it, what happens when the rubber meets the road, what happens when federal funds and when state funds end up in the hands of the citizenry, and what are the requirements and the repercussions of those things. I have a long experience doing those things, and I think that experience will hold me in good stead on council.
Very good. Well, thank you very much for coming. I'd like to introduce our last candidate, Juan Chadis. If you could come up here, he is a former TV professional, former director of New Essex County MHMR Centers, and he's a native to Lubbock. Welcome.
Thank you.
So first, tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you the best candidate.
Juan Chadis, born and raised here in Lubbock. Did move to Corpus Christi and apologize to no one for that. I was there for 28 years. Lucky enough, I had a good marketable job that took me there. My career in TV, producing and directing. Upon retirement, before that, I worked with Essex County Mental Health Mental Retardation. I was a safety inspector, safety coordinator. I managed a $2.5 million contract for people with disabilities. And again, as soon as I retired from there, here I am. Mm-hmm. I want to run for city council because I've been sitting outside and seeing these atrocities in the neighborhoods. Crime rates are high. Neighborhood housing deteriorated. Again, I lived for 30 years. Hey, those neighborhoods that I'm referring to were in pretty good condition. I get back and I say, hey, what's happened? You know, I lived 30 years ago and things are falling apart. Again, I'm not a lifelong member here, but I grew up here. So I decided, hey, what better way of correcting these issues than becoming active in city government? And here you have it. I'm active, I'm going to make a change.
Very good. And if elected, what steps do you think that you can take to help reduce our city debt?
City debt. You can't, it's like running your household. You can't spend what you don't have. It's real simple economics. By consolidating right now at the Omni building, great move. Hey, you're saving $900,000 in rent. Great move. Let's do that. Let's continue doing that. Don't spend what you don't have at the expense of the citizen. You can't continue to do that. As a city councilman, I will be closely scrutinizing all of these expenditures. Hey, don't spend it. We don't have it. You're leasing out police squad cars. Hey, you know what? Let's save the money. Let's pay for them. That's what needs to be done. Accountability. Don't spend what you don't have. It's like running a household. This is just a bigger house. But we gotta take care of that.
Very good. And what is an important issue to you that you believe faces your city or district? And if elected, how would you address it?
I made issue to it or a reference to it. Accountability, absentee landlords. My district, 15,000 households, 15,000, picture. Two-thirds of those are renter-occupied. 10,000 of these homes are renter-occupied. What's being done? These absentee landlords are not taking care of their property. Accountability. I've spoken with Stuart Walker in code enforcement. He's for it also. But again, how do you monitor 10,000 properties? You've got to have the neighborhood associations being active, policing the neighborhoods. Vital. It's your neighborhood. I'm part of that neighborhood. But we as a whole, as a populace, we need to take accountability for this. There's a boarded up house. Why is it boarded up? Why isn't the landlord taking care of it and renting it out, taking care of it? Houses with canvas tops because they don't want to repair the roof. I don't want to live under these conditions. And I know the people that are renting the property don't either. So let's hold these landlords accountable. Accountability is a key issue in my campaign. Law enforcement, crime prevention, what's being done? I say let's put the police force in the neighborhoods with substations. The chief already says that's what he wants to do. I'm in complete support. You've got to have police presence there. It again, accountability. The populace relates to the police officer that they see. Great rapport, man. I mean, you trust the policeman. You know him by name. Now he can walk up to the citizenry in the neighborhood. They know him. Hey, he's a good guy. You don't put your hands up. You don't run or you don't get on your knees. You know who this guy is. You trust him. And now the seedy element, if you will, says, hey, these guys are here. These guys are serious about fighting crime. I'm going to change my ways, or I'm going to be housed at the state level. That's what I want to see. Let's clean up these neighborhoods from the housing to crime. And again, we as the citizens of the neighborhoods, it's our responsibility to do it. But everybody is real complacent, sits back in the chair, and you know what? Let's let somebody else take care of it. Those days are over when I get in. I'm going to start holding people accountable, as well as myself. You know, and I keep telling people about open door policy. Hey, knock on my door, people are coming up to my house, knocking on my door, we sit down, get a cup of coffee, and we talk.
And pertaining to annexation of property outside the city limits, if elected, how would you protect private property rights while still encouraging the development of our city?
Annexation's a heated topic. Heartbreaking story, Miss Crum lives in the neighborhood that they're trying to annex. Elderly lady, her remark was, they annexed my house, I will have to sell because I cannot afford property tax. How can this be possible in today's society? To force a family to sell their property because they can't pay taxes. I'm a proponent of 212. That's a 20-year moratorium, if you will. I'm a proponent for that. I would have to, again, meet and listen to the area, the citizenry that is being, trying to be annexed. And let's sit down, let's see if we can come up with some type of agreeable plan. Unfortunately, sometimes there is not an agreeable plan, and things have to happen. But I will advocate for the areas that do need to be annexed, or that are trying to be annexed. I will listen to the people that are being impacted by that. I want to be, okay, I'm being elected to represent District 1, but you know what? I'm the city councilman for the entire city. That's who I am. You know, the area that's been annexed on the south side, it doesn't affect the citizenry in District 1, but it affects the city of Lubbock. I'm the city councilman for the entire city. When decisions have to be made, I've got to be there. I've got to be held accountable for anything that gets enacted. That's what I want to do.
Very good. And regarding water usage during times of drought, which system of conservation do you feel is best for our citizens and business owners?
Zero escape. Starts with an X, not a Z. It's got, there should be some incentives there. Go to Home Depot. They will tell you what plants, what trees, what shrubs are drought tolerant for the city of Lubbock. That's what needs to be done. And the city again, and again, I apologize. I don't know if there is an incentive program at Home Depot or at Lowe's or any of the other home building areas, but there should be. Maybe as the city councilman, we can go and talk to these home builders, or not home builders, I apologize, they're selling these shrubs and whatnot. Maybe we can ask them, hey, let's have an incentive. We want to save water. And Lubbock has a pretty good program at this time. But again, the zero escape, water runoff, let's claim it and let's reuse it. And again, the water drought system, the policies that are on board right now, I'm all for it.
Very good. And what level of involvement do you feel the federal government should have on our city government?
I say minimal. But again, if the city's not taking care of itself, then somebody else is. That's when the big boys step in. So let us take care of our own properties, our own city. Let us, again, accountability, let us take care of it. Because if you don't, somebody else will. It's our job to do it. But again, I'm there. You're there. All the candidates, we're going to be there. But if we don't do our job, somebody else is going to do it for us. And I say, I'd rather take care of it myself than let the federal people come in.
Very good. And what role do you believe the city government should have in emergency management services related to weather disasters?
Coming from a safety background, big proponent. You can be proactive or you can be reactive. I want to be proactive. There's a storm coming in that we knew of possibly a week ahead of time. Let's prepare for it. Do I want to drop blame on anyone? No, I don't. What for? It's history. Am I going to be shedding a new light on something? You know what happened. I want to be proactive. Let's start working on the issues before the storm gets here. It's real simple. Buy heavy equipment? No. It's going to sit there for another 10 years, collect dust, and then the citizens of Lubbock get to pay that debt for equipment that's going to be sitting in the garage. Because I know I wouldn't buy a vehicle if I knew it was going to sit in my garage for 10 years and continue to paint on it, then just sitting there, and if you don't use it, it falls apart, it deteriorates. So no, buying equipment, I don't think that would be my issue.
Great answer. And then just a quick closing statement for
everybody. Reference was made to NEL CDC, North and East Lubbock Community Development Corporation. I'm on the board of directors there. I'm a member of St. Joseph's Catholic Church. I'm on the finance committee. I'm on the board of, on the parish council. I am a member of the Knights of Columbus. I'm the Grand Knight. Involvement, I've met with all the candidates that are running for mayor. I've met with two of the previous mayors for Lubbock. I've been networking, guys. I haven't been sitting around the house waiting for somebody to do things for me. I meet with people, I talk with people. People knock on my door and we sit and we talk. That's my policy. I've got an open door. When I get into city council and I don't say when, I will be there. My door will be open. If the door's open, come in. That's my policy. You see me walking down Amigos? You want to sit down and talk? Let's go grab a coffee. Let's sit down and talk. That's what's missing in government. People make you promises and then they get there and you know what? Turn you back. I don't know who these people are anymore. Not me. I'm there and I'm there to serve. And I thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. So for those candidates that are still here, I'd like to let you know we have the room for about until about 1:30, so you can mingle with some of the folks that are still here. And I'd like to thank you for joining us today and speaking and taking your time. And then all of the audience members that are here, thank you so much for showing up. Please remember that you need to be checking lubbockliberty.com. Go and check that come Monday and Tuesday of this week coming up. And this video will be on there. Please share that to any of your friends and family members and members of the community that are interested in being a part of our local government and participating in government, because it is ours and we are the government and we should take it over. I thank you so much again. I'm Amanda Smith from Lubbock Liberty and I appreciate you all being here. And if you have any questions, please let me know. Stick around for a little bit, chit chat. And I hope to see you at our next event, and I'll be sending out some information about that. And if you are interested in getting more information about Lubbock Liberty, please come to me and I can take your information down and send you out some mailers. Thank you so much.
Are you old enough to vote?